Good morning, everyone. Good morning, and welcome to the 2016 Economic Outlook Breakfast. If we can start by standing and saluting our flag of our great nation, if you'll please join me.
Now you
place your hand over your heart. Ready?
So instead of sitting in our waiting area, you could be shouting.
To the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Well, welcome. We're so excited to have a full house this morning with us, and excited that you all made it out so early. I know many of you are not morning people, so I promise we have plenty of coffee in the back. Feel free to help yourself at any point. As we were, looking to our Economic Outlook Breakfast this morning and what we really wanted to talk about, we felt that there's so many great things going on in the economy right now. And we've all heard the studies that have been out about Ventura County maybe not recovering as quickly as some of the other counties here in California. But we know that there's also a lot of great opportunities. So we really wanted to focus on those opportunities and look at the positive side of our economy. We decided that we wanted to focus on some of those founding industries that really helped to shape Ventura into what it is today. And two of those industries are the oil and agriculture industry. So we'll be celebrating those industries today, taking a moment to look back into kind of how they got started and what their impact has been over the years, and looking at the current operations, some of the challenges and opportunities that they have before them. And then we'll ask our speakers to do the impossible, right? And look into their crystal balls and look out into the future and maybe give us a glimpse of what can be coming in the next few months, few years for their industries. These industries not only affect Ventura and Ventura County, but they have an impact statewide as well as nationally. So it's for those reasons that we have chosen that, our past, present, and future, as our topic this morning. I hope you'll enjoy the speakers. There will hopefully be a short amount of time at the very end of each of their talks for some questions and answers. We'll have some microphones out in the audience. If you'd like to ask a question, just raise your hand. Additionally, we'll finish off the program today with some good news. And this is literally where we go out into the audience. We tap a few members who are here today and ask you to tell us about what's happening in your industry sector, what's happening in your organization, and share that good news so that you all get a little bit of that insider information before you head back to work. I do have a couple of thank yous that I'd like to start with. First of all, I'm gonna be a little self-indulgent here. I'm gonna call out my chamber team. So ladies, if I can have you stand up. We are a small but mighty team. There are five of us in the office. Becky Haycox, Jessica Perkins, Ashley Pope, and our newest team member, Sam Dyer. We had a little computer issue this week, which is never fun on the day of an event, but they handled it with incredible aplomb, so thank you, ladies. Also, I'd like to recognize some folks who are here with us in the audience this morning. First, from our city, we have several council members. First, council member Cheryl Heitman. Good morning. And Councilmember Christy Weir. Thank you. We also have several representatives from other offices. So representing Congresswoman Julia Brownlee, we have Brad Hudson. And representing Senator Hannabeth Jackson, Michael McDonald. I'm not sure if he's here yet this morning. Representing Assemblymember Doss Williams, we have Angelica Cisneros. And representing Supervisor Steve Bennett, we have Steve Offerman. Thank you all for taking time to be here this morning. We appreciate that. And now I'd like to ask our hardworking chamber board members to stand up and be recognized. We have a 26-member board of directors that work in their own industries, and yet they still find time to help us out at the chamber in their volunteer positions. So please stand and be recognized. Thank you for your hard work. And with that, I would like to call up the 2016 board chair, James Pereiro, with Myers, Witters, Gibson, Joan, and Feingold.
Thank you, Stephanie. Well, I think it's safe to say that almost everybody in this room works in Ventura or has business ties in the community. And many of us, like me, not only work here, we also live here, which means our kids are in the schools, maybe our grandkids are in the schools. Now, there may be some people in our community that take for granted the quality of life that we enjoy in Ventura. That is not this room, right? The fact that you're here means that you are not a passive beneficiary of all that's good about living and working in this community. You're invested. You're here this morning because you're committed to developing your understanding about making the local economy strong, making Ventura thrive. You're starting new relationships and continuing to strengthen old relationships with people who are also likewise committed to helping Ventura's local economy. So whether you're just inserting yourself in the conversation for the first time about the local economy and what it means to make this community work and function well, or whether you've been in this conversation for the last 50 years, as the board chair and as a person who works and lives in Ventura, thank you for your commitment and thank you for being here this morning. In particular, there's some folks that I would like to point out without whose support this event would not have been possible this morning, and these are our event sponsors. So I'd ask that you hold your applause until the end while I tell you who they are. Our presenting sponsors this morning are Brooks Institute and the City of Ventura. Our platinum sponsors are AT&T, Community Memorial Health Systems, Kaiser Permanente, and Montecito Bank and Trust. Our gold sponsors, Era Energy, California Resources Corporation, Ventura County Credit Union. Our silver sponsor is Tolman & Weicker Insurance Services, LLC. Our bronze sponsors are Gold Coast Acura, Gold Coast Transit, Pacific Western Bank, Ventura Community Bank, Ventura County Star, Ventura Rental Party Center, Western States Petroleum Association. And our media sponsors, Caps Media, Gold Coast Broadcasting, home of Q104, Live 105.5, KVTA, Old School 95.9, and Radio Formula 1400 AM. Lunars Production Services, VC Reporter, and Ventura Breeze. Please join me in thanking our event sponsors. And now I'd like to take a moment to recognize our Chairman Circle members. At the Diamond level, we have Brooks Institute. At the Gold level, we have AT&T, Community Memorial Health System, Kaiser Permanente, and Ventura County Star. At the Silver level, Era and Montecito Bank and Trust. At the Bronze level, E.J. Harrison, California Resources Corporation, CSU Channel Islands, Gold Coast Acura, Gold Coast Transit, Hofer Enterprises, Marriott Ventura Beach, Myers Witters, Gibson Jones and Fine Gold LLP, Pacific Western Bank, Southern California Edison, Swift Chip, Tolman & Weicker Insurance Services LLC, Union Bank, Ventura Community Bank, Ventura County Credit Union, Ventura Rental Party Center, and Western States Petroleum Association. And our media sponsors, Caps Media, Gold Coast Broadcasting, Lunars Production Services, VC Reporter, and Ventura Breeze. Let's thank our Chairman Circle members. And now, please join me in welcoming one of our two presenting sponsors to the stage, the Provost of Brooks Institute, Tony Johnson.
Thank you. Good morning. I am very happy to be here with you this morning. As I said, I'm Tony Johnson, and I'm the provost at Brooks Institute. I am relatively new to California. I come all the way from Kansas City as my home, so I'm from the Midwest, home of great jazz and barbecue. And so I, first of all, I'm very honored to have an opportunity to address you, especially from a county perspective. Being kind of a new resident here, and I do live here in Ventura County, it was a wonderful experience for me to move here. And as a part of Brooks Institute, and even from a personal level, I'm very vested in this area. I think that this is one of those kind of quiet, hiding little diamonds that is out there for all the world to see. So Brooks has been very busy lately, as most of you are aware. Not only are we involved in our normal, regular routine of educating students to becoming those great, creative, successful visual professionals that we do, but we're also in the process of relocating to downtown Ventura. And so that is one of the big excitements for us. One of the speakers earlier talked about the different opportunities that are available here in Ventura County, and Brooks definitely saw this move as an opportunity for our school individually. So we are looking very forward to being a part of downtown. We are not looking to just be your neighbor. We are looking to be a member of the family. There's a difference in being a neighbor and being a member of the family. If you're just a neighbor, you just kind of wave and kind of nod your head as people go in and out of their homes. But as a member of the family, you get to know each other. We want to get to know the businesses of Ventura County. We want you to get an opportunity to know us. We want to work together. We want to collaborate together. We want to support each other. When you have an event, we want you to let us know. We'll be there. When we have events, we want to let you know and you'll be there. So it's more of a relationship, more of a culture that we really want to try to bring with us as we come into the downtown area. So we're all very excited about that and we're looking forward to it. So hopefully the next time I come before you, I'll get to know a lot of you more by name as opposed to by face, because we'll all be family at that point. I would like to take a few minutes just to kind of recognize our Brookies that are here. So first off, I'd like to ask if there are any Brooks alums that are in the audience anywhere, if you would stand on your feet, please. Any Brooks alums? All right, kind of low on nap, that's okay. We do have some members of the Brooks staff and maybe some current students. So if Brooks staff, if you would stand at this time and be recognized. Hey. And then we also have a couple of members of our owner company, GP Homestay, who just happened to be in town this week doing business with us. So if our representatives from our owner company would take a moment to stand at this time and be recognized. So again, like I said, we're looking forward to being to becoming a part of the family. We've already started working in partnership with several organizations. We continue to look forward to do that. So like I said, we do see the opportunity. We do look forward to working with you and just looking forward to the future. So thank you very much for this time.
Thank you, Tony. And on behalf of the Chamber, welcome to the family. We're really excited about all the things that Brooks is doing in and around and for Ventura right now. And now for a few words from presenting sponsor of the City of Ventura, please welcome City Manager Mark Watkins.
Hey, good morning, Ventura. Happy to be here. Thanks to the Chamber. It is so wonderful, all the things you do. We truly appreciate it. Bringing folks together, we're all proud and happy to be part of this community. You make such a difference as a Chamber for the entire community, of course, especially for the business community. I love the theme today, past, present, and future. One of the slides that came up showed the 150th anniversary logo. So this has been a fun year for us. It's been a special year as we reflect back on 150 years of success. All the things that happened before us and the wonderful legacy that those before us have left for us to enjoy. And then it was so fun to follow Tony and Brooks, because that's part of our future. As they come downtown and are bringing students downtown and getting more of that critical mass into our downtown, where we've got a, not just a fun place on the weekends, but enough people downtown during the week and other times that we've got that energy going all the time. So we're looking forward to having you downtown, having the young folks downtown. I just toured with Lee, our some of your buildings yesterday, kind of look at the effort, and it is amazing the amount of work that's going on in these buildings and the amount that's going on with the remodel. So that is part of our future, and we're excited about that. And then part of our present, I was going to share just kind of two things with where the city is on economic development and some significant actions by the city council over the past couple weeks. And so from my perspective, obviously as a city guy, I think that we are the ones that provide the foundation upon which buildings and businesses can grow. And so you don't think of a lot of the things the city does, but we are the ones that provide the streets and the storm drains, the water, the wastewater, the traffic signals, the trash services, making everything go the way it's supposed to go. And then, of course, on top of that, there's public safety and making sure that folks are safe and secure in their homes, safe in their businesses, that you've got an environment that you know is going to be a good place to do business. And so in a lot of ways, that's the city's contribution to economic development, is providing that foundation. We provide the backbone, and you all do the rest. And that's our role, is to make sure that all of those things are well provided and that you can build on what is there as a community. And my background is public works. I'm a civil engineer, grew up in the public works, and I used to say the difference between a first world and a third world country is public works, and is that infrastructure, is the ability to keep the lights on day in and day out and to have clean water and take care of your sanitation. And you do those things as a government entity, and then the business community can thrive and it can do what it does. The other city also has an economic development committee from the city council. They focus on that. We've got a new economic development manager, brought in another staff person, economic development. So it is a focus of the city. It's something that's one of the city council's goals. It's something they focus on and recognize the importance. And then as far as kind of our present and partly our future, the last 2 weeks, city council's adopted a couple of significant items. 2 weeks ago, they decided to put a half-cent sales tax measure on the ballot. And it wasn't something council took lightly. It's been a foundation of Mayor Eric Nasarenko's term as mayor. Mr. Nasarenko's on vacation this week, or I know he would be here. And that is based upon this Monday's actions, which was adopting our budget for the coming year. And so on the good news side of our budget, we have a balanced budget, very transparent. There's no borrowing. The city has adopted an honest budget. But on the bad news side, we have not restored any of the services that were cut back during the recession. So the city lost almost 100 employees during that time, reduced service levels across the board, and none of those have really crept back in. So we're holding on, we're balancing our budget, we're providing services, but we've still got a fire station that's open with one-time funds. If you recall, we closed the fire station out on Telephone Road at Montgomery. We reopened that with federal grant money. We've received two grants, and we're in the process of trying to get a third, but we're not funding our public safety at the local level. We're not paying and paving our streets. We're not repairing our sidewalks. We're not keeping the medians and parks up to the level that we know you all want. And that's our contribution to economic development. We don't want to bring people downtown and then focus on bringing people to town and then not have them pleased with what they find when they get here. And so that's where council has gone with trying to figure out how to raise revenues. Raising revenues, I think, is on the forefront of many people's minds here. And the way that you do it as a city is through tax. And so you do it through property tax or sales tax. And in this case, council is looking to do a sales tax. So you'll hear more about that, and your council members will be out talking about it. I'm sure others are talking about it, but I just want to make sure that you know it was on their agenda. There's going to be a lot of items on the ballot this year, from SOAR to a sales tax measure to I hear there's something going on the national level even. So that'll get people's attention, but make sure and pay attention to what's going on your local level. Do your studying. Decide where you stand, and make sure to have your voice heard. So happy to be here, James. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Mark. We appreciate all the hard work you and your staff do to keep everything running in Ventura. And now I'd like to introduce our first speaker. Edgar Terry is engaged in agricultural production with his family company, Terry Farms Incorporated. Terry Farms produces various vegetable and strawberry crops on 2,000 acres in Ventura County, California. Mr. Terry is a senior adjunct professor at California Lutheran University, where he teaches corporate finance in the Degree for Professionals Evening Program and the Master of Business Administration program. Please join me in welcoming Edgar Terry.
Thank you. Thank you, good morning. And I was just listening to the comments by the speakers, and my wife Martha and I were in Georgia the last 3 days for a board I'm on, and a lot of the members of the board always ask me, there's only two of us from California on the board, and they ask me, what's it like living in Southern California? What's it like being a farmer in Southern California with the population and the ag-urban interface? And I go, it's great. I go, it's wonderful living next to the beach. We have a year-round climate where we can grow 365 days a year, and then I'll promptly asked them, what's it like to live in upstate New York being a dairy farmer when it's minus 40 degrees? I told one of them, who's a dairy farmer in upstate New York, I go, I didn't even know minus 40 was a real number. So he goes, it is, Edgar, it is, but you know, you don't know anything about that. So anyway, I thought I would put on a short PowerPoint and talk about ag here in Ventura County. And obviously there's been some articles in the newspaper the last couple of weeks about some large operations that are shutting down. And if you want to ask me about those later, you can if we have time for it. However, let's start with my PowerPoint and see where it takes us. One of the interesting things I think about ag in Ventura County is that it's roughly 4% of the GDP. And when you think about that, that's amazing, because in the U.S., ag's about 1.5% of the GDP. So ag here in Ventura County is a major industry. It's in excess of $2 billion, and I'm not sure if you add in all the ancillary things that go on what the total amount is, but $2 billion is a large number. In fact, Ventura County, as an ag county, is in the top 15 of the nation. Now think about that. When you get in the Midwest, we've all been through the Midwest, and when you drive through the middle of Nebraska and you see miles and miles of nothing but farmland and the counties out there, Ventura County is in the top 15. And probably when you look at the value per acre produced here in Ventura County, we're probably one or two, maybe Napa may be ahead of us, but we're certainly one or two in the U.S. when it comes to value per acre. So, and I think that's probably more instructive than just looking at gross value. Anyway, if you could flip the slide. Oh, I do that. The big thing in ag here, and why we can do things the way we do it, is the first bullet point's the weather. The weather is so important in Ventura County for the productivity and the crops which we grow. And that can't be understated. There's nowhere else in the U.S. that has what we have in Ventura and Southern California. The land is fertile. The topsoil here is unbelievable, and that's why we can produce strawberries, that's why we can produce raspberries, that's why we can produce the celery and all the crops that you love to have. The ground here is just tremendous. The third bullet point, though, I think when I go and talk to groups, this may be one of the most important. We're all risk takers. We all love to throw the dice. And being risk takers, sometimes you roll a seven, otherwise you can roll craps. And I think this is one of the issues that going forward may be more problematic. And as the city manager has said about, you know, after the Great Recession and services that have been diminished, we're seeing this in agriculture. Risk-taking is a very difficult proposition. Even though the cost of credit is at historic lows, the risk appetite for the lenders is not what it once was. So this is a big, big reason why you're seeing agricultural organizations get bigger, because its economies of scale, its ability to have the right hand of your right hand side of your balance sheet capitalized correctly. And as a smaller grower, and I'll consider ourselves smaller growers, it's tough to compete. So you've got to find that niche, you got to find that window that works for you, and you got to make sure that if you're going to go out and take a risk, that you have the capital to do it. We are a direct reflection of what we're seeing at the retail side. The retail side is consolidating. There's less and less stores out there, more big box stores. The big box stores want to do business with fewer and fewer growers, so that is causing us to get bigger and bigger to be able to meet that demand. None of you go to the grocery store and demand to pay a higher price, right? So we need to figure out better ways of doing what we do to meet that demand. We also are, especially in Ventura County, I can honestly say we're on the cutting edge of development. At this very minute, there's two fellas from Spain working on a robotic strawberry harvester, Juan Bravo and Francisco. They are from they're from Lepe, Spain, a large strawberry growing area. They've moved their operations over to here, to California, and they're having great success in developing a system that automatically will pick strawberries. It's fascinating to see what they're doing. And as the labor force, demographics of the labor force go down, we need to figure out better ways of being able to do what we do. And I'm convinced that robotic harvesting with the new technology and the computing processing power that we have today is going to be an integral part of that, of being able to compete. Second thing there is substrate. You're noticing more and more of the crops grown here are under hoops. If you look closely, some of those crops that are under hoops are actually being grown in substrate soil. That allows a number of things to happen. It controls disease pressure in this age of no methyl bromide and less access to fumigants. Substrate soils allow us to control disease pressure in the fields. And more importantly, you can immediately become organic. You don't have to wait for the three-year transition period. The soil is immediately organic. Consequently, you can enter the organic market more quickly and effectively and be able to produce crops at a higher productivity per acre than we normally would. The other thing is that there are crops being grown here that when I grew up, I never thought about one. Raspberries, obviously, are a big crop. But blueberry production is starting to ramp up in Ventura County. Now, you always think of blueberries as Oregon, Washington, places like that. But we even have a half-acre hydroponic blueberry facility behind our strawberry fruit stand. And it's amazing the productivity that you can crank out from that. And so people, the big question is, do all of you consider hydroponic growing agriculture? I hope you do. There are a lot of folks out there that think, well, that's not agriculture. That's just factory farming. No, it's not. It's not factory farming. I guarantee you it's not. It's just another methodology. It'd be no different than if I went into your office and said, get rid of all your computers. Would you accept that? Of course not. It's another way to be productive is to figure out better techniques to do what you do. This might go along with what we've read in the newspaper, but there was a famous economist from Harvard named Joseph Schumpeter, and he coined the term creative destruction. And creative destruction, we all know, means that if you don't continually improve yourself and improve your own organization, what happens? You leave. So the way we think of ag 40 years ago, 20 years ago, last year, is totally different than how we think today. We have constantly have to think about reinventing ourselves. Martha and I have our two children involved, William, who's 30, my daughter Alyssa is gonna be 26. Believe me, they think about things, millennials think about things differently than a 56-year-old does. They think about meeting market demand much differently than I did when I got out of college. That's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. You know, the past is a past. Let's think about the future. Let's see how we can innovate and do things differently and not be held to old beliefs. And I think if we can do that, the success of agriculture in this county is unlimited. I really do. There's a lot of young kids that are starting to get into it. My generation, my age group, there was very few of us that came back to the farm. I'm really happy to see that my son's age group, Mario sitting out there, his age group that are helping the farms be more successful, that's great. I would encourage your kids, if they're young enough to think about a career, think about ag. It's not a traditional thing you think about when you go to college. It's okay, you don't have to major in ag. I didn't major in ag. My daughter was a Spanish major, and she's in ag now. It's great. It's wonderful. It's a great career. Food delivery systems are changing. That's a given. Now, we all think about, let's go to the farmer's market, and that's wonderful and great, and you're supporting local farmers. That's wonderful. But who would have ever thought Costco would be, or and Walmart would have grocery stores in them? And a lot of people love to shop there. And they have changed the industry dramatically. And a lot of the producers that grow for the Walmarts and the Costco, they actually contract a year in advance at a set price. That was unheard of. When I got out of college, the market changed every day. You didn't know if you were gonna get $12 a box for celery or $2 a box for celery. Well, now there's a little bit more predictability with the shippers in produce that they can sell their product and know what the price is gonna be out in advance. Now, the downside of that is you have to deliver the product. You don't deliver the product, that can be a problem. You may lose your contract. But our methodology, consumers have all changed in how they shop. Yeah, there is a local food movement, and that's great. It's wonderful. But for the vast majority of people, if you go to the Midwest where it freezes in the wintertime, you're not going to go to the local farmer's market on a Saturday morning. You're going to go to the grocery store, and that hasn't changed. It's just what the grocery store and how they're structured have changed. I think this is really interesting to look at. We all talk about how much disposable income we spend on food. And you can see the 1929 to 2012. And I haven't done the math recently to see what we're at, but it's roughly a little over 9% of our disposable income goes to food. I think that's amazing because when you go to Europe, it's more than double that. And Europe subsidizes their growers to about a third of their production costs. We don't. You spend less on food today than you ever have. And that's a good thing. Because obviously, if it went back up to 24 or 25% of your disposable income was being spent on food, you can imagine the social unrest you'd have. People view food differently than they view an Xbox. That's unfortunate. When I talk to my students at Cal Lutheran, and I love to sing the praises of what I do, they'll ask me a question. Ed, what makes you any different than what I do? And I go, what do you mean by that? Well, I'm a scientist and I'm trying to create a cure for cancer. You're a farmer trying to produce food. We're no different. And once I started to hear that when I started teaching 28, 29 years ago, kind of it changed my mindset. I mean, I really feel what I do is very important. Producing food, I think, is really important, and doing it the right way is important. But then when you listen to somebody who works in another industry, think about their job as passionately as I think about my job, I think that's a good thing. You know, we take it seriously what we do, and we should all do it to the best of our abilities. Let's talk about Ventura County, and this is why I'm encouraging you to tell your kids to get into agriculture. The average age of a farmer in Ventura County is actually in excess of 60 years now. And when you look at the citrus industry, it's probably closer to late 60s. And this is not uncommon. This is what we're seeing nationally. This is why there's a big movement to encourage more kids to get into agriculture, because we're all getting older, unfortunately. And people don't think about ag as a career, and I hope people start to do that, because if it keeps growing the way it's growing, the end is self-evident. I love this quote. I always like to give this quote from a Wall Street Journal article by Peter Drucker. It is always amazing how many of the things we do will never be missed, and nothing is less productive than to make more efficient what we should not do at all. First night of every class, I give this quote. How many things you do at work, think about it, are unimportant, and you spend a lot of time doing it? And I think Drucker was correct, but he goes on to talk about all the different industries that there are. And he said the most productive industry, the most growth in productivity we have ever seen by any one industry has been agriculture. In 1933, roughly, one farmer fed 19 people. Today, it's one farmer feeds in excess of about 150. No other industry has seen that productivity growth. And the U.S. feeds the world, obviously. And this quote, and this will hopefully end on a up note. This was given to me by Sam Hackett, my economics teacher at Buena High School, one of the best teachers I've ever had in my life. And I took a class with him called Directive Study Economics. There were two of us in the class. And he wrote this on the inside of a book he gave me when I graduated. The soil is productive less because of its natural fertility than because the people tilling it are free, by de Tocqueville. I think that speaks volumes about agriculture. Yeah, the weather's great, the soil's great, all those things are wonderful and they do help, but it's because we're allowed to make our own decisions on how to be productive is why we're so productive. It's the ability to have that freedom of choice, that decision-making ability, that risk-taking entrepreneurial spirit allows us to do this. Otherwise, we wouldn't be productive at all. And I think to Tocqueville, when he was doing his tour of the United States 250 years ago, was probably seeing why the U.S. was growing so rapidly as compared to France, and it's because of the growers, and he was looking at farmers, were allowed to be free to make their own decisions. Anyway, thank you much, and if we have a minute or two for a question, I'll take it.
We're going to have to move on to our next speaker, unfortunately, to stay on topic. Thank you, Ed. Apologies for that, but we want to make sure we try and get everybody out on time today. And I'm sure our speakers will be willing to stick around afterwards to answer any additional questions you may have. So now I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Bob Poole. A Central Coast resident since 1975, Bob Poole currently serves as vice president with the Western States Petroleum Association, a position he's held since 2015. This is his second tour of duty with the association, serving in a variety of capacities from 2002 to 2011, including overseeing all California production regions, along with work in the areas of offshore platforms, marine, and property tax. Between 2011 and 2015, Bob served as public and government affairs manager for Santa Barbara County-based oil exploration and production company, Santa Maria Energy, where he was part of a successful team effort obtaining permits, an environmentally innovative project, producing domestic energy from abundant local diatomaceous earth deposits. Bob has also served as the president and CEO of both the Goleta Valley and Solvang Chambers of Commerce and is a former small business owner. Bob currently serves as the chair of the Ventura Chamber of Commerce 2016 Energy Committee. Please welcome Bob Poole.
Thanks. Am I on?
There we are.
I'm going to step down and walk around because I'm ADD. So thank you for the opportunity today to talk a little bit about energy. The past, present, future theme, I'd like to kind of tie that together and short order by saying we've had a proud past of energy here in this county. How many of you know we've been producing energy here for well over 100 years? Yeah. So that's the past. The present is, and this gets to the future, the petroleum industry is a cyclical industry. And as you can know, we're kind of in a down cycle right now. So, but at the same time, there are a lot of exciting things happening, a lot of innovation in a lot of areas. And also, there's a lot of information out there that maybe isn't getting out. And I think that the future conversation is that energy is a very complex set of issues. We truly are a carbon-based economy, and we're going to be that for a while. At the same time, making decisions about energy, we need to make informed decisions. And one of the things that excites me in my job is there's a lot of information out there that I don't think folks are aware of. I think they're critical to our decision-making going forward. So that's the future part of it. So there, I've done it, past, present, and future. Now, what I would like to do is focus, though, on energy, water, and economics. I have 26 slides. I have 15 minutes, so hang on. And I will be available for some questions afterwards. How many of you know how many barrels of oil California uses every day, each and every day? Anybody have a guess? How many?
900.
Anybody else? That's getting closer. It's 2 million. 1.8 to 2 million barrels of oil California uses every day, each and every day. We only produce about 38% of that on average, about 700,000 barrels. Does anybody know where we get the rest of it? A lot of it comes from Saudi Arabia, that's right. Canada and Mexico are the two number one suppliers of oil to the United States, Canada being number one, Mexico number two, but not California. We don't have any pipelines coming in here from Canada for oil. We have natural gas pipelines. All the oil that comes into California comes in over tankers. It either comes down the coast from Alaska, a small amount of that, and that amount's going down. Last time I saw was 12 or 13%. Most of it's coming in from the Middle East, coming in from tankers. An average tanker is about a million barrels, the super tankers. So if we're importing about 60-some percent, we're importing about 1 to 1.2 million barrels of oil every day overseas into our ports. So if you think about it, and it takes about 27 days for a tanker to get here from Saudi Arabia. So if we got a million barrels a day we're importing, right now, if you visualize it, there's 30 tankers about a day apart lined up making their way here just to California. Anybody have any awareness of that? Probably an important component of our decision making as we talk about energy, isn't it? Because we need to take responsibility for that, all of us, because we all use that oil. Enough preaching, I wanted to set that up as a start and a frame on our conversation. So WISPA, we're a trade association. We represent 26 companies, I think, mostly the larger ones. that do everything from get the oil out of the ground to put it in your tank, fully integrated companies. In the five western United States, mostly California, because that's where most of the oil is, Mother Nature blessed us here, whether you agree with it or not, with lots of oil. And as I mentioned before, this slide, the crude slice sources here, everybody can see these. This kind of reinforces what I'm saying here. But you can see that the California line's going down, the Alaska line's going down, and the foreign line kind of going up, isn't it, kind of? So here's some more fuel facts, California. Here's where we get our oil. As you can see, the pie there. Saudi Arabia, 29%, Ecuador, 22%, Iraq, 15.9%. Canada is 3.7%. This is California. So we're the third largest producer of oil in the United States. As I said, right now about 610,000 barrels. 75% comes from San Joaquin. I'm going to tell you in a little bit how much comes from Ventura. 92% of our oil is produced onshore. And we'll get to the economics because this is an economic outlook. Based on this slide here, it generates and supports almost 500,000 jobs, generates $21.5 billion in state and local tax revenues. Oil companies, some of the largest property taxpayers. And as most of you know in this room, about half of that property tax dollar goes to general services, essential public services. The other half goes to education. So here's where the California, or where the oil is produced. You can see Ventura's there. Now Ventura's colored the color that it says 1 million to 10 million. In fact, in 2015, there were 8 million barrels of oil produced in Ventura County, about 8 million metric cubic feet of natural gas. Here's that slide. There's currently 19 producers, 716 wells, 8,400 total wells on file. 500,000 barrels almost was produced just in January 2016. So if you extend that out, obviously production potentially is going to be lower this year. But demand's not going down. This is pipeline network, just major pipelines in the United States. As you can see, the reason I use this slide is to reinforce that comment I made earlier. We don't have any pipelines coming into California bringing crude. It all has to come in over the ocean. If we don't produce it here, we import it over the ocean. Natural gas, we all use that. Very important. By the way, did you know natural gas is petroleum? A few years ago, the California Energy Commission got confused and they didn't realize it was a hydrocarbon, so anyway. Here's some more fuel facts. This is what we need to take responsibility for as we're making these decisions. 92% of our California transportation fuels are petroleum-based. That's just a fact. 40 million gallons of gasoline every day. Third largest fuel-consuming entity on Earth. You guys know all this stuff? Somebody saw me before, huh? You know it. Oh my goodness. Give me your email, I'll tell you where I'm gonna be next. So we got 38 million of us, 48 million by 2040, 26 million cars. Our governor not too long ago said, hey, we gotta take responsibility for that. If we don't produce it here, it's gonna be produced somewhere else. Anybody ever heard those four letters, CEQA, California Environmental Quality Act? If you want to think global and act local, we should produce our oil here. We're going to use it. We're going to need it. And why not do it in the place where we can do it with the most stringent environmental regulations in place? So here's the energy reality. This comes from the U.S. Energy Information. We are making strides with alternatives and renewables. The situation is, though, it's such a significant, enormous challenge. These are projections. By 2040, we're still going to be using petroleum for 32%. 2012, it was 37%. We're making great strides. That doesn't even include natural gas. You add that up, that's 62%. Coal's a hydrocarbon as well. Obviously, a whole different set of circumstances there. But if you add up all the hydrocarbons our society depends upon, it's well up there in the range of 70-some, 80%. Renewables, we're making great strides. nuclear, I understand the second power plant here is going to potentially close. I think originally the two nuclear power plants are producing about 15% of our electricity. Where is that going to come from? More than likely right now it's going to come from natural gas. So here's what makes up the price of gas at the pump, if anybody's interested. Is anybody interested in that thought? So you can see crude oil makes up 38%? 26% of its taxes. If you go to another state, you'll realize that, well, the reason the gas is cheaper there is not because they have some magic other formula, it's because it's less taxed. California has highest taxes in the United States. So there it is. There's a little snippet that kind of tells you what's going into it. You know, the average return on investment for oil companies is about the average of all industries combined. Runs in the 7 to 8% range, I think. Fracking. Just skip through some of these. Hydraulic fracturing. This was a report that was done by the California Council on Science and Technology think tank, Lawrence Livermore, Lawrence Berkeley. They found there's no evidence for all the things you're hearing out there. And how many of you think hydraulic fracturing uses a whole bunch of water? You've heard that, haven't you? Well, it uses a lot more water back east in the Marcellus or in North Dakota, but here it doesn't. And there's not a lot of fracking going on anyway. The nature of the geology doesn't lend itself to horizontal drilling as much, and so therefore that whole thing figures into less of a receptivity to that. So the total amount, and I'm not bashing any other industry here, but the total amount of water used statewide by residents, according to the Public Policy Institute, is 64.5 million acre feet. 323 acre feet were used for fracking in 2013. Oil production and water. How many of you heard we use lots of water to produce the oil? We actually produce more water than we use in a lot of ways. It's an interesting conversation. We purchase 1% of the water. Most of the water we use is 99%. An average of 15 barrels of water is produced with every barrel of oil. Most all of the oil in California is in what are in marine sediments. There used to be seas over this whole area, and so the carbon matter, the plants and animals and all the things that made up that were trapped in sand and sediment, and they went down and down. So when we're producing oil, we're actually producing more water than we're producing oil. We're producing brackish salt water, ancient salt water. We clean it up, we use it to produce more oil. We give it to farmers to use, I'll show you that. So we're actually net exporters of water, believe it or not, in most instances. Have you guys heard that story? No. I didn't think so. All right, this is just a slide that goes further. So we provide 8% of the water we produce to agriculture. We use it in our other operations. We recharge aquifers with it. 75% of it is used to get more oil out of the ground. Here's a little recap of that. Water provided to ag, 46.1 million barrels, 2015. 3.8 million barrels to recharge aquifers. Okay, the economics. So in our industry, I told you before, about half a million jobs. This is a report done by the LAEDC, Los Angeles Economic Development Corporation. You can see here. This is available. Give me your email, I'll send it to you. Lots of economics there. 2.7% at California total employment. By the way, these are high-paying jobs. Living wage, head of household jobs at entry level a lot of times with our field techs, et cetera. We have a great story to tell there. Ventura County, same thing, LAEDC. The industry generates 12,500 total jobs. That's direct, indirect, induced. You work for an oil company, you get a paycheck, you go buy groceries. The guy that you bought the groceries from takes that money that he made and goes and buys a car. Direct, indirect, induced, the velocity of money turning. OK, can see the industry's total value to the county's economy, $2.7 billion, or 6.5%, $121.6 million in county property taxes. Thank you. Any questions? Did I do that in under 15 minutes? Lightning speed. Thank you.
Well, let's give a warm round of applause for both of our speakers this morning. So as we've just heard, agriculture and energy production have played a critical role in building our community. They continue to support and sustain our community in many important ways in the present, and hopefully do so for many years to come. But as you know, these two industries are really just a part of a larger story of what's happening in the local economy here. So to help us round out the picture of what's happening, what our economic outlook is for Ventura this year, I'd like to ask Stephanie Caldwell, our president and CEO, and Lee Eisen, the economic development director for the city of Ventura, to join us as we share some good news about what's happening in the business community. So Stephanie and Lee, take it away.
Thank you, James. Well, we are here. We have council member Cheryl Heitman, who has some good news. She's going to be representing Era Energy with a special announcement. So Cheryl, what have you had for us?
Thank you, Stephanie, and thank you for this great presentation. Really, always very educational, so always enjoy it. Thank you. So my good news involves a public-private partnership, which is such an important part of our economy, and I think we don't often think about how important that is, especially for city government. And in this case, it's a partnership with the city and Era Energy. And so today, I have the honor of announcing that Era Energy is making a gift of $30,000 towards our development of Kellogg Park, which is a park that we are actually in the process of developing on the west side of Ventura. Much, much needed park. And you're saying, well, what does that have to do with economics? It has a lot to do with it. It has to do with our quality of life. It has to do with our health of our people who live here. It has to do with the vitality of a region. And Era Energy has been a particularly strong partner in helping us do all kinds of projects on the west side. So we want to thank Era Energy, who's sitting at their table, to let them know how much we appreciate this public-private partnership and how important it is to the economic vitality of the city of Ventura. Thank you.
Thank you. Lee, take it away.
Thank you, Stephanie and Cheryl. I'm here with Jordan Elias from Brooks Institute, and we know the Brooks Institute has lots of good news, so tell us.
All right, there's a lot. As you've heard, we're excited about the move to an urban campus in the downtown location. As of this moment, we've secured about six locations, all within walking distance from each other. So what you want to do is keep an eye out for the Earl Stanley Gardner Building on California and Main. That's going to act as our welcome center, as well as like a gallery. Dr. Cliff, our president, wants this to be like walking through the mind of Brooks Institute, which should be interesting because we have some creative minds at our school. Another building is the fourth and fifth floor behind City Hall. And we want to first apologize to Stephanie and Becky for all the noise we've been causing. We heard a window broke not too long ago. Thankfully, everyone's safe. But we'll have photography studios and various student services there. Talking about local partnerships, we've recently signed an agreement with the newly renovated Clock Tower Inn. And they have about 50 rooms, and a portion of those rooms are going to be allocated towards student housing. So I think we have about 17 students on the list as of now. We also have and want to continue our global partnerships as well. So to give you an idea, we signed a memorandum of understanding with the largest film school in China, which is Beijing Film Academy. And we're working on a program where it's called 2+2. They go to school there for 2 years, and then they move to Ventura for 2 years. And so we really want to bring this international presence to Ventura County as well. As far as timeline, we plan on bringing 50 to 60% of our classes, faculty, and staff right before September, with the remaining 40 to 50% right before January. So thank you to Ventura, the city of Ventura. Thank you to all of our partners for making this happen so quickly. Now, there's a lot going on. You can keep up to date on our website. There's a relocation tab. If anyone here has any creative ideas on how your business we can work together, please come see me after. I'd love to partner up, and if I can't find the answer, I'll find someone who can. So, thank you.
Thank you, Jordan. Stephanie, what else is good?
Thank you, Lee. And Jordan, no problem. We call that the sound of progress. So we're excited and looking forward to all the students and faculty that will soon be in downtown. Well, I'm here with Gary Wild, the president and CEO of Community Memorial Health System. And I think Gary has an update for us on the new hospital.
Stephanie, thank you. The hospital is going on very well. We'll move into the hospital about this time next year. It'll be done, according to the contractor, in early next year, maybe January 27th is the date. So that's good news. There's about 250 high-skilled workers on the block, three different contractors. One's building a parking structure. One's doing all the infrastructure work around the hospital. And, of course, the third one is building the hospital itself. We've also just approved construction of a new OHI skilled nursing facility, 75-bed facility, and we're remodeling and renovating in a lot of our ambulatory care centers. So we're keeping the construction business in good work. We've also, over the last couple of years, added about a little over 100 full-time equivalents, high-wage jobs. Half of those are new physicians in training. We've started a training program for physicians in family medicine, internal medicine, general surgery, orthopedics, and then half are other registered nurses and others. So we're trying to do our part to keep people well. We're keep having more and more patients come to our facilities and keeping them well. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Gary. Go ahead, Lee.
Thank you, Stephanie. I'm here with Nan Drake of E.J. Harrison & Son. Nan, tell us what's good and what's new.
Well, actually, I'm here just to introduce one of our new generation of leaders in the Harrison family, Jim Harrison's son, who is also our project engineer, Mike Harrison.
Thank you, Nan. I'm excited to be here today. I'm excited for the future of the waste management business and our partnership, continued partnership with the City of Ventura, and carrying forward the vision of my grandfather, which was to be one of the first waste haulers in the county over 80 plus years ago. In 2003, we were one of the first liquefied natural gas stations to be constructed, and now we're one of the first to build a compressed natural gas station, which is to go online probably next month. So we're excited about bringing in the clean energy and doing our part to be a sustainable environmental partner. So thank you.
All right, I'm over here in the corner with two folks from the Ventura Auto Center. I have Jeff Suquet, who is the president of the Kirby Auto Dealership Group, and Michael Kozakowski, president of Gold Coast Acura, with some special news from the Auto Center.
Thank you. Well, real quickly, the Auto Center, if you haven't visited, has gone through a lot of changes. We have a new owner for Gold Coast Acura, that'd be me. We have, and it's doing well, by the way, I noticed our sign, no. Ventura Volkswagen's moving from the city down by the mall to the Auto Center. The construction started, the ground's been started to be graded, so that's gonna be beautiful for the Auto Center. Kirby Kia's remodeling, the roof is missing, it looks good, so it'll be a beautiful building soon. Land Rover Jaguar is actually gonna be starting a process of remodeling, so these are all good things, employing more people, more contractors. And then as the Auto Center's entity, Jeff will talk a little bit about what we do, but as a group at the Auto Center, we're one of the largest tax generators, sales tax. You know, automobiles are a little pricey. The Auto Center employs over 700 people, and our payroll's a little over $38 million. And all that money gets put back into the community in buying other things besides cars and big appliances and stuff. So, Jeff, what else do we have going on?
Good morning. There is a misconception in our industry that we just have beautiful cars for everybody to test drive and look at, and if they want to buy, they buy. It's an interesting industry, but we do more than that. And the misconception is the more part. We, as independent private auto dealers, are very involved in charity events. Some of you folks in here know that because we have done sponsorships with others. but a lot of people don't know that, but we have quite a few mothers coming into our businesses asking for donations for the daughters cheerleading, and they have Simi Valley license plate frames on, so they do the traveling for little donations. But the dealers, we now have yearly financial allotments strictly for charities, and we do quite a bit of charities. There are 9 dealerships in the Ventura Auto Center, including Mr. Hofer has and owns, his family owns the Auto Center, which he is right up there with us when we're giving to the city for their 150th anniversary, making the $25,000 donation. We, in 2003, saved a library in Ventura from closing during the recession, $67,000 that the auto dealers invested to keep that open. Those are things that people don't hear, don't see. We are there for the homeless. We are there for any nonprofit charity to help. And that's the other side of what we do. We just don't sell cars. So I just wanted to, which is good news, I just wanted to make sure that that misconception is cleared up and that we do a lot of co-sponsoring with our partners in here. And Michael and I are making a commitment to Stephanie that we are going to be more involved going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Ventura Auto Center. I am pleased to introduce Marlis Oster, President and CEO of the Ventura Visitor and Convention Bureau. Marlis, tell us what's new with tourism.
Okay, lots of good stuff going on. First and foremost, Sunset Magazine has named Ventura a finalist for Best Beach Town. Woohoo! So we're holding out hope. We'll find something out in August, but we remain optimistic. In partnership with the city, it is the Bureau's goal to increase the transient occupancy tax by 3% annually. And I'm proud to say this last year, we increased it by 13.4%. So that is great news for Ventura. And we're actually on pace to do another great year. Right now, year to date, we're up 4.8% in occupancy. So we're gonna have, and that's, we haven't even hit our season yet. So it's gonna be great. We're excited. A couple more things. Amgen was awesome. It was really about bringing the community together and getting some coverage for Ventura. We got international coverage. We got about $30,000 in digital value. We reached over 3 million people, and we invested our staff time and $3,000. So that was definitely worth it. And then last is everybody wants Ventura branded items to take with them. In the last 3 years, our visitor center has increased 390% in sales. Good news.
Thank you, Marlis.
Congratulations, Marlis. I am here with Kevin Clarisi, who is the executive director of the Downtown Ventura Partners, and I know that you have lots of good news to share.
Yes, downtown is buzzing, truly. I really appreciate Tony saying about the family, because our family is really growing. We're grateful and we're humbled that Brooks has chosen to bring their campus downtown. But that's not all, actually. We have, in the next couple of years, you will see over 400 market-rate homes that have been entitled that are going to break ground. Marlis talked about the wonderful gains in the tourism industry. We have a 4-star hotel that's in the planning process. We have another boutique hotel that's in the planning process. Traveling over here this morning, I saw a couple things I haven't seen for a while. At the top of San Juan Road, I saw demolition of a dilapidated old building, and that lot's being cleared for additional housing, which is exciting. And when I drove by the Elks Lodge this morning, I saw construction of new homes that are coming in. I want to close, too, by saying and welcoming and, in fact, inviting all of you to come to our annual 4th of July celebration in a couple weeks. This is a terrific family-friendly event where we're going to have thousands. So please join thousands of us as we celebrate downtown and our wonderful community. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. Back to you, Lee.
Thank you, Stephanie and Kevin. I'm here with Herbert Schwinn of Ventura County. Tell us, Herb, what's new with the Ventura County Medical Center?
Thank you, Lee. As Lee mentioned, my name is Herb Schwinn. I'm the Engineering Services Director for the county's Public Works Agency. Our group is responsible for the management of the design and the construction of the new VCMC hospital replacement wing. The good news I'd like to share with you is that we recently passed the milestone of 80% complete on our hospital wing. We expect the wing itself to open sometime around the first quarter of calendar year 2017. The work itself will continue because the contract includes some renovation to the existing hospital, so the actual contract doesn't end until near the end of May. But we have, at any given time these days, between 200 and 250 workers on board. If you're ever able to take a tour, you'll see actual flooring finishes going in, ceilings going in, painting going on, so it's really starting to take shape. And if you look at the outside, you'll see the decorative screening that's going up. Besides the improved health care that the project is going to deliver to the county's residents, we like to see if there are other ways we can evaluate other contributions of the project to the county, the county's investment in the hospital. Because it's a public project, we see all the payrolls for the workers that the contractors have to submit. So we know that so far about 50% of the wages that have been paid to tradesmen and tradeswomen, if you will, on the project are going to people that list Ventura County as their home of record. So to date, about $40 million in wages and benefits have been paid to workers on the hospital. That's not the engineers and the consultants, that's just the tradesmen themselves. And about half of that, or $20 million, has been paid to people that call Ventura County their home. Besides that, our contractor, Clark Construction, we've looked at other secondary effects that they've had. They've spent over $1 million on local supplies and services, everything from printing to renting equipment to custodial services, catering services for company events and so forth. And then about four or five of their staff have permanently relocated, if you will, to the county, and they're renting their homes, their apartments, they're seeing movies locally, they're shopping in our grocery stores and so forth. So we estimate that impact at about $1 million also. So besides just the improved health care, the project we think is really helping spur the local economy to a great extent. And I'd like just wanted to share that good news with you, and I hope to see many of you at the ribbon cutting the first part of next calendar year. Thank you.
Thank you, Herb.
Thank you, Herb. We're looking forward to that ribbon cutting. Just one more thing before I turn it back over to James. If you have good news to share, I know so many of you out there have great things going on within your organizations or within your industry sector. If you just send me an email, we will make sure that it gets out to the chamber community. We have a vehicle to be able to spread that word. It happens every single week, usually on Wednesdays. There is an e-news that is sent out to nearly 4,000 contacts. So if you'd like to get your good news into that e-news, just send me a quick email. I promise it's very painless, and it will reach a lot of eyes. So please keep that good news coming. And let's give another round of applause to all of the folks who shared their good news this morning.
Well, we heard a lot of information this morning from a broad array of industries. One of the themes we heard was challenges. Certainly when it comes to agriculture, we heard about the challenge of how to innovate in that industry and what it means to meet the changing demands of our economy with respect to what people expect at a grocery store. Certainly, we're all familiar with some of the challenges facing energy production in this country, and I think many of us learned new facts about how that impacts California specifically. But we also heard the importance of innovation and the ways that people are innovating and working hard to think creatively about how to solve the challenges facing each of their industries. And we heard reports, not just from Bob and Ed, but from a lot of people in the room about the hard work and the energy that people are putting into taking risks and moving their industries forward. So I am very encouraged by what I hear, And seeing the news and the information and the things that people are doing right here in Ventura encourages me and makes me excited to have this be the place I've made my home and the place where I work. So we've got a lot to look forward to here in Ventura, and I just want to tell everybody, keep up the good work. You guys are doing great stuff. So I want to let a couple announcements. There are some gifts from Brooks Institute and the City of Ventura awaiting all of us on tables immediately outside of the ballroom. So I'd like to encourage everybody to stop by there and pick up a couple of items provided to us by our presenting sponsors this morning. And a few more special thanks before we conclude to the Marriott Ventura Beach, Lunar's Production Services, CAPS Media, and of course, once again, to all our sponsors and Chairman Circle members. A housekeeping note, if you parked in the Marriott lot, the gate will be up when you leave, so thank you, Shannon, for that. And thank you all for coming. Make it a prosperous day.